Hello, everybody. Alex, actually, just in preparation of this talk, asked me if I have a lot of experiences with these kind of talks, and I told him that I was living a long time in China, and I usually would start something like "Nüshamen, Xianchamen, Dajiahao," greeting everybody in Chinese. But in Berlin, it's definitely the first time for me at TOA. I'm very proud to be here with such a nice guest, one of our clients. We are talking about, is the presentation starting, some of the most urgent issues in our cities today and what, how Volocopter is contributing to traffic solution in urban airspaces, inner city solutions. We all know that there are certain issues, challenges that all our megacities are facing today. And we are working a lot with very different mobility providers in the sector on new mobility patterns. We know what's changing in the big mega cities worldwide, but they develop from big mega cities with a strong focus on automobile to smart cities and multimodal solutions. One of the big mega trends, I'm sure you're also very well aware of it, is the move from owning a car to sharing mobility modes and from hardware-driven products to software-driven solutions. There is a big move also for, not only for the automotive industry, but for all mobility providers worldwide. They talk a lot about from driving experiences, but there is a big shift towards in-vehicle experiences. Of course, this is mainly also related to autonomous driving, autonomous solutions in very different vehicles. And one of the last topics I'm talking about before I introduce Alex is also there's a big shift from product manufacturers to mobility service facilitators. So changing mobility needs and the development of smart cities demand to really rethink how the infrastructure transportation really works in our big cities worldwide. So how do cities really evolve? What kind of new challenges and opportunities are there outside? And one of the biggest game changer for me in our agencies is the 3D mobility that really reduces the load on our current infrastructures in cities and conquers the airspace in cities worldwide. I'd like to shortly introduce a few people that really became heroes in this field. The first one, already in 1782, the Montgolfier brothers, they invented in 1782 the first hot air balloon. The second hero I'd like to just briefly talk about is are the Wright brothers. They developed, innovated the first controlled, really sustained flight of a powered aircraft. And the third would be Paul Cornu. He developed, invented the first helicopter flying off the ground in 1907. The first manned flight in 2011 with a multicopter coming from a whole helicopter is this guy. And this is really something we'd like to focus on today. I brought this video. You see it's highly in testing period, but this movie was already done in 2011, and only 7 years later, we will introduce how the project really evolved. So what do all of these people really have in common? It's very easy, the dream to fly. We have one of these people here today. Let me introduce Alex Zosel, co-founder of Volocopter. Alex was there with Volocopter and the video you just saw before, right from the first minute. He is from the founding team, developing the product, the technology behind it. He is one of the forward-thinking leaders in the whole topic urban air mobility. I have a few questions to you, Alex. We know that Volocopter is the urban air mobility pioneer in the whole field. How would you describe what makes Volocopter really unique?
So I think what is really unique that on one hand, our plan is to bring air mobility to everybody, so to democratize the, this kind of flying, so not to develop a shuttle for the rich people, so really bring large-scale mobility in this kind for everybody who lives in the city. And on the other hand, to be a global player out of Germany, to be accepted in America or China, it's not so easy as a small startup. But in the first 7 years, just we focused on a good partnership with authorities. So we really reached in early times the first permits to fly with a electric multicopter all around Germany, for example. The whole world was shocked that the regulators in a country like Germany will make something like that. And so we really worked the last 7 years. Our customers are the regulators. This is really a funny thing. Everybody asks you, oh, regulators will be a big problem for you, sure, and you have to go outside other country because Germany is really awful in that. No, that's not. For that, I think we are really the pioneers in this area because just all over the world, the regulators in aviation ask us to help them to implement a new situation to regulate these things. And so we work together with a lot of authorities, and we get really money from them to work with them together. So it's for a startup, it's really a strange situation that our customers are authorities in the first 7 years of the company. And here you see now a movie. There we were paid from an authority in Dubai to make test trails of a fully autonomous flight in urban space. And the flight you saw before with me was 1 year before, so the authority wanted that there's nobody on board to show that it's fully autonomous. And
it's fully electric.
It's fully electric. It's have a lot of separated powertrains, so it's really safe. And
What would you describe as really competitive in the market with all the competition you see in the market? What makes the product, the Volocopter, really special?
It makes really special because 7 years ago, after that flight with the yoga ball, that was also our team, we decided to develop an aircraft for the inner city. So we decided not to make complicated technique, so we stayed as a pure multicopter with just no mechanics. And on the other side, we develop it to be as quiet as possible, because we think if you have a market in urban space, in a city, the noise is really the key factor to be accepted in the city as a new mobility service or mobility kind of mobility, if all the people who don't use it are not in stress with having this in their city. And so that's a little bit unique. So we accept that we cannot fly so long with the existing batteries. And
would you say it's safe to fly autonomously?
So fly autonomous is like car driving autonomous. If it's really working good and reliable, it will be safer than a pilot who can make mistakes. But also from the regulator side, we have since half a year now a new regulation published by the EASA, the European Safety Agency of Aviation, and they decided that an air taxi operates in inner urban space has to be as safe from the system as a commercial airliner. Mm-hmm. And that is the thing we decided 7 years ago, that we want to develop a system that is as safe as a commercial airliner. And so, for example, a traditional helicopter you see outside flying rescue, for example, is from the regulator side, has a commercial airliner 1,000 times safer, so 1,000 more flight miles to have a first accident, for example. And they said, okay, it's not enough to be as safe as a helicopter, you have to be 1,000 times more safer than a helicopter. And that's for us good, because we are working since 7 years on this to make it as safe as that. And some competitors has now to work hard to get this also.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, one of the greatest projects that was also just announced in January doing green tech here in Berlin is the infrastructure project you're working on. What would you change are the big, what would you say are the big challenges when you develop an infrastructure in cities?
So there are, I think, two challenges. One is a digital infrastructure. This is completely in parallel like autonomous driving. So we need ground-based GPS, secure digital back end and all these things. But on the other side, we have also to change the infrastructure in concrete. And so when we want to provide and service in large scale, so that are, for example, 1,000 or 2,000 people per hour can take in and fly off in one spot, you have to develop a real new technique. And so we are sure that we need a kind of hub, like a parking garage, with all these things from battery storage and battery changing and parking the aircraft, so that it has to be like a floating system, like in a cable car station or something like that. This is the main aim in the end, to have large scale. But it's also one of our DNA that we choose a very pragmatic approach. So we are thinking about a system in the future, working on it, but also to start in a small scale with the first station, for example, where only every 15 minutes, for example, can one aircraft take off and land to make the first experience. And then we came now to the partnership with Linda and her team to develop the first station where you can take in and it's more about also a user experience, how it must be that the people accept that service, and it's also how to get into this aircraft in a seamless way and be connected to the other mobility in the city. And so they are really experts in that, and I think you can tell something about that.
Yeah, but I mean, it was an international competition with really very high profile people working on it. What made you assured that this concept would be the one you'd like to go with?
So we had a pitch with several architects, also from London and other in the world. We had really nice presentations. But what was for us important that we found here in Berlin with the Brand Lab and Graft people, that people, they are thinking about branding, user experience, transforming into the buildings, and not only from the architectural design. So they connected also all the digital world around it, all these things. And this was the factor we say, okay, this is the right team, we want to work together.
And we can actually also announce that the very first mobile station will be built within this year in Singapore. So if you're around to the end of the year, please visit us there and check it out. I'd like to also have a few more images on that to introduce the project. We developed an architecture with a customer journey that is very flexible in use. You can either land on top of a building and go down with a volocopter, or there is also a platform outside the building, and the robot brings the volocopter inside to just easily and safely get out of a volocopter or also board. I have a few slides that also explain the concept behind it. For us, it was really important, starting very initially with the thought about the dream to fly, what would we would really like to achieve, and what needs to be incorporated into the architectural design and the whole customer journey. For us, it's two main topics. First, what we really associate with the sky, with flying, is transparency, it's freedom, it's lightness. And at the same time, we'd like to also incorporate things that really make us feel comfortable with not only the infrastructure, but also with flying a volocopter, to feel secure, to feel cozy and safe, very grounded and foreseeable. We'd like to present the new design that brings together the fusion between the sky and the ground in an architectural design. What we right from the beginning said that was also really important to Alex is that we talk about a seamless connectivity, where we challenge the whole concept on really enabling a very effortless experience from buying a ticket to check in, to just sitting in a lounge, to transparency and information and boarding information, till you're really bored and get explained a few handling procedures and just flying away.
So I can say we already, there are some helicopter shuttle services all around the world, for example, Sao Paulo, it's called WOOM, for example. And this is a really bad experience. We made different tests. So the helicopter is somewhere on a helipad and there's an outdoor fire stairs and you have to go out in the wind and it's really awful. There's no really user experience to use this common shuttle as a helicopter. And so we want to be really completely different to that, because we want that really everybody likes it and not only the people who needs it really out of safety, for example, in São Paulo, they use it more than as a, not under mobility issue, it's out of safety. And they accept that they are treated as a passenger like shit, because the infrastructure is not built for that. It's only for rescue, for example, on that buildings. And so we said, no, we can really only be successful in a large scale usage when we make it really comfortable and accessible for all people. So and for that, we decided to build up our own infrastructure.
We have two interior views here as well, where we say an easy access and the feeling of trust that also Alex talked about, as well as a huge amount of transparency to see the Volocopter at all times when you enter the station and you're sitting down in a lounge where there's a visual connection always to the vehicle. And comfort are really main things. What made you really think about the interior? What are you expecting what people should really feel when they enter the Voloport?
So it's you don't have to have stress, you have to be feeling comfortable, but you have also the feeling that you're not waiting as a fool on your slot, so it's has to be also a seamless and fast situation, but also you can come a little bit earlier and enjoy and see what happens there. So it's in the beginning, it's really important that the first routes have really a comfortable situation, and also people you can ask about the service and have a personal contact to somebody. And this is for the first entry of a market like this, really, really important for us.
How does the check-in actually really work?
So the check-in, it could be that you are checked already in when you are picked up in a port like this at the hotel, for example, already for the flight. So we are having also partnership, for example, with Fraport. They are the company who runs a lot of airports in the world, but also Frankfurt Airport. How to integrate a service like that into an airport, though, that you can check in the hotel, you can fly just direct to the gates. There's a port or a hub, something like that. And so also the check-in process must be a seamless. And there are a lot of new techniques where you're with face recognition and all these things, and via app or something else. And for that, we are working, for example, with provider for airports on this theme to have a seamless. But if you have a service in a city, you don't need border checks or something else. It's just like jumping in a taxi, but you need some security levels also for that.
And when you look at inner city locations, why was it really necessary to develop a project that offers different possibilities of operations and takeoff and landing? Can you talk about that? I mean, the concept we also wanted because we were offering two different options, that it's possible to fly away and land on top of a building as well as from a platform outside.
So it's not only to have a flexible in infrastructure. You see here, we can take off on the building, get down in the building, or on a seaside. So there are some combination possibilities. But also what is for us important, that these ports are also prepared for other air taxi providers, because there are about 200 companies in the world who want to produce air taxi. I think 20 to 30 are really serious. Other a lot, a little bit more in the future and having only renderings, but also big companies are working on that. And we need to create the infrastructure where also other concepts, aerodynamic concepts, can take off and land. This is really one also important factor on that.
And also concepts where you can really grow and are very yeah. modular and flexible in terms of where you really implement this infrastructure within inner city location.
Yeah, you see, for example, on the right down, it's a tower. It's something like a hub. We are not. We have developed the real concept behind that with a floating system and all the needs inside this building. But we think we have to start with a small first real situation. So we build up the first port. You saw the rendering. We build it like this, like you saw on the renderings, to make the first experience. How we handle the battery swapping. Want to see that the people can see what is happening, though they have trust. If they see, there will be the battery swaps. I get new batteries. If you can see it, you have a little bit more comfortable trust in that. So these things, we want to make the first learning curve on learnings. And I think in the next 2 to 3 years, we will really start to build up perhaps a first prototype of a hub where, for example, 1,000 people can bark and embark in 1 hour. So. It's. I think it's the first step, but it's important that we will really build up the first thing this year in Singapore.
We have also one really picture amazing. Here. We are just calculating the first mobile prototype, how we fit this into containers to make it possible that we ship this also, the first prototype, to different locations to really test not only functions, but also operations. Yeah. The first one will be built in Singapore. Do you foresee any other stations?
All over the world. So I think we will start with first point-to-point rounds. Mm. So we need perhaps two or only an A-to-A round, like you have a small tourist trip to make the experience. So I think it go faster than we all think that we build up more of these ports, because we have a partner who invested also in that. It's a company called Skyports out of London. And they had a lot of already booked claims where they can build up these ports. And it's also interesting who pay for that infrastructure. We had a lot of demands in the years from real estate who said, okay, please give us a handbook or specification for a station on our new skyscraper or building. Because if we have this new kind of mobility on our top of our buildings, we can charge more for the rents or to sell the apartments in a huge amount. So they want to build up that on their cost and say, okay, if you get your things, you can have it. We rented you for a small ticket for 20 years for a fixed ticket, for example. So that we don't have to, as a small startup, to get the invest for the whole infrastructure, because the real estate, they want to do it. And also Singapore, it was funny. Already 2 years ago, there was a meeting in Singapore with also other air taxi providers and the authorities of Singapore, and they told us, please give us the handbook or specification for air taxi ports on the buildings. We will change the building regulation of the city, that every new building we will build up here in Singapore has to build up a port like this on the rooftop. We can change the building regulation, and we are not prepared on that. So that is really the regulators are the enabler of these things. They want to have it. They see it's possible. It's from the technical side, it's real. So we, as the pioneer in that area, we fly since 7 years. More than a thousand of test flights. We have 3 generations of aircrafts. We make manned tests. We are flying manned, so it's really nearer than all the people are thinking around that this kind of mobility is coming.
It's also very outstanding from official authorities to be so future forward thinking and really demand technologies like this. Would you say, like, we know that Asia is probably the market that is really requiring things like and concepts like this? Are there any other regions in the world that are as keen as Asia?
The Middle East, for example, Dubai, mm-hmm. they want it as fast as possible, and they want to have it immediately fully autonomous. Yeah. We say no, we don't want to deliver fully autonomous as mm-hmm. a first customer service. Mm-hmm. We want to start with pilots. But also here in Germany, we have a lot of politicians who are standing mm-hmm. behind us. There are some budget already to have flying test areas in Bavaria, in Hamburg, here in our region, in Baden-Württemberg also. So it's really also something for Europe. It will come all over the world, and we don't know where we have the first really customers to use this service, pay for a trip. But we want to start just in every continent in the world with just in the same time. So we don't know where will be the first one. It depends on the regulators, how fast they are. But it's something for the world, not only for Asia or something. Yeah.
You were already talking about a current challenge, but this is also licensing and official regulations. Could you just in one sentence say, from now in 10 years or 15 years, what's next? What's coming?
So we think that in 10 to 15 years, we have really implemented 10 of connected systems of air taxis in 10 megacities of the world. So that are they are flying, I think, thousands of these aircraft in some megacities. This is what we are sure that it's will coming in the next 15 years.
What I'm actually really excited is about that, especially in science fiction movies, years and years ago, there was this dream of flying in inner cities, but this is actually now already becoming true. Thank you so much, Alex, for being here, and you as our audience. I was told that we have around 3 minutes if there would be any questions. So I see a few of the questions on the screen. One would be, when will it be introduced in Germany? You already just said that the authorities in Germany are also really on the topic. Can you foresee that there's something happening?
So what is introduced, we're flying since 7 years in Germany with permits to fly from regulators. But the aim is also in the next 2 to 4 years having the first routes in Germany to make learning curves in your direct surrounding. It's really really good. So we are working hard to have the first routes also in Germany, for sure, in the next 2 to 4 years, I think.
And one question would be, do you really think the technology is available for just regular people?
That is, for that we as founders of the company, when we founded the company, that this is our approach. We want to build flying for everybody and not a toy for rich people. And for that, it's really developed in really urban space, large scale usage, because if you only produce 100 aircrafts per year, it will be really expensive. If you can produce it in large scale, then it could be cheaper. And to operate this is not expensive, but to produce for sure. And the biggest cost driver is batteries. So in the beginning, for sure, it will be a little bit more expensive than a trip with a black Uber Black, for example, limousine service, but it's far away from having a helicopter trip.
One last question would be, how do you manage airspace? Like, is there, we are reading also articles, especially from the America, that airspace is also just one of the biggest challenges in the future?
Yes, so we see how open the regulators are. So for the first rounds, we'll getting special conditions. And for sure, we have to have safety landing spots, having a digital infrastructure only on that route as an experience phase, for example. But the whole world is working on digital infrastructure for autonomous driving, and this is just the same technique with a little some additional things. But this is a task the whole world is working on it and on autonomous mobility.
Our time is over. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Alex.
Thank you, Alex and Jennifer.